Hello friends, a warm welcome to yet another interesting session on instrumentation and control in power plant industries. Our today's topic of discussion is rotameter. So in this session we will be discussing about what is rotameter, how does it work, its basic principle, what are its different parts in industry, what different type of rotameters are used, and particularly in what applications they are used, advantages and disadvantages of rotameters, and much more. Friends, we discussed in our previous session that fluid flow rate is equal to area into velocity. That means flow is directly proportional to area. That is, as the cross-sectional area of the pipe increases, the fluid flow rate increases, and vice versa. This fundamental gives birth to variable area flow meters called rotameters. So our first and foremost question is, what is rotameter? We can say rotameter is a variable area flow meter because in this meter our area of fluid flowing is varying as the fluid moves up or down in a taper tube. So we can say rotameter is a variable area flow meter that measures volumetric flow of liquid or gas. It is reliable, simple and low cost flow measuring instrument. Sometimes these rotameters are also called gravity flow meters, mechanical flow meters or variable area flow meters. Now coming to its different elements, that is the part of rotameter. Basically a rotameter has three main parts. First part is a uniformly tapered flow tube. Second is a float that rises up or moves down depending upon the pressure exerted by the fluid entering the rotameter. And the third is a measurement scale that is actually a calibrated scale in which the float position is calibrated to see the corresponding volumetric flow rate reading. Other than these three main parts, a rotameter also has a vertical guide wire to restrict flow movement along a vertical axis only. And also definitely for installing in the process line, we need a certain connections, generally flanged connections at bottom entry as well as the top exit side. Coming to the working of rotameters, the tube is placed vertically such that the narrow cross-section side is in the bottom and wider cross-section is at the top. The entry of the fluid is from the bottom and exit is from the top side. This fluid entering from the bottom side inlet strikes with the float, and due to the force exerted by this fluid, that is the drag force, the float rises up. The float is attached to vertical guide wire to move up and down along a fixed vertical axis only. As the float is placed in a taper tube, the upward movement of the float creates annular space between the float and the walls of this tube. Larger the amount of fluid flow, the higher is the float raised, and thus more will be the annular area to allow passage of the flow between the float and the tapered wall of the rotameter. Clear? Means we can see in this diagram, the red one is the float, bottom side this fluid flow is exerting pressure on this float and this float is rising up. As it rises up, this spacing, the annular space between this float and this walls of this tube walls, basically this tube is taper shape, so more the float rises up, this annular space is increasing, so more fluid can flow. The larger the amount of fluid flow, the higher the float is raised, and thus more will be the annular area to allow passage of the flow between the float and the tapered wall of the rotameter. Clear? Now coming to float position, which makes this measurement possible, that is basically the equilibrium position. We talked about that the drag force which the fluid entering the rotameter exerts on the float from the bottom side, that is the drag force that pushes up the float. Whereas the gravitational force, we know, pushes everything down. So from bottom to top, it's fluid drag force, and from top to bottom it's gravitational force, which is our mass into gravity. So equilibrium is when upward and downward forces are equal. Clear? The process reaches an equilibrium when the upward force, mainly the drag force, equals the weight of the float. This gives the float a fixed position with no movement. The height gained by the float as it moves is proportional to the rate at which the fluid is flowing. That is, the height reading can be easily taken from the side scale marked on the tube. Actually, on this scale, the reading is not in terms of height. Rather, the calibrated value of the flow rate corresponding to that float height is displayed on this scale. Next, coming to the type of rotameter based on their vertical tube material of construction, that is the MOC of the tube itself, we can classify into three types. That first one is our glass tube rotameter, second is metal tube, and third are heavy duty rotameters. So our glass tube rotameters, here the tube is made up of borosilicate glass and the float can be metal, glass or plastic. In case of metal floats, stainless steel is preferred to avoid corrosion. Glass tube rotameters can't be used in water over 90 degrees centigrade with high pH, which softens the glass basically. And also in wet steam application, these glass tube rotameters cannot be used. Moreover, if the fluid contains caustic soda or hydrofluoric acid, they basically dissolve the glass itself. So these rotameters, glass tube rotameters, can't be used in those applications. Now, second type is our metal tube rotameters. Here the tube is made up of aluminium, brass or stainless steel. So one thing is clear, that all these tubes are opaque. So, but these can be used for high temperature and pressure. And since this tube is not transparent, thus the float is not visible directly for changing flow indication. So mechanical or magnetic followers are used to determine the float position. In some case, spring and piston combination is used to determine the flow rate of hot waters. Hydrofluoric acid, fluorine, hot and strong alkalis, steam, slurries, molten metals, additive, etc. Best part is they can operate up to a pressure of 750 psi and up to a temperature of 540 degrees centigrade. And it can measure volumetric flow up to 4000 gallons per minute. So coming to our next type is heavy duty industrial rotameters. These are basically flanged armored rotameters, and their enclosure is coated with special material to increase their strength. They are designed to accommodate heavy industrial environment. They often have a scalable 4 to 20 milliampere output that provides much greater immunity to electrical noise. Coming to the installation, point to remember are, it shall be installed vertically. Second is the flow direction is from bottom to top. And coming to the straight length requirement, theoretically there is no pipe straight length requirement for rotameters, but still it is advisable to give some minimum straight length before the flow enters the rotameter to get laminar flow. Now talking about its advantages, first, it needs no external power for its working, unlike rest of the other flow meters. Second, it is very simple and reliable design. It can measure liquids as well as gas flows. Its scale is approximately linear, and it can measure even corrosive fluids. Better rangeability, low cost and low pressure drop. Now talking about its negatives, we can say that fluid temperature variation can change the fluid density. The instrument calibration done at one temperature condition may not give correct reading for all different temperature conditions, as the fluid density will be different. Second is it is used only in vertical, means direction, so that is one of its disadvantage. Next is the glass visibility can be an issue, and it cannot be used in case of opaque fluids. Moreover, what I have seen in power plants, generally it is used as local gauge or local indicator. In case of 4 to 20 milliampere conversion, as mentioned, using magnetic floats is little bit complicated. So friends, this was all about rotameters, their principle, their application, their limitation, and their specific installation. Hope I am able to clear the concept well. We'll meet you in our next video. Till then, stay safe, stay healthy, take care, bye.